ओम श्री अरविंदो मीराय इज माय रिफ्यूज। वंदे मातरम, नमस्ते, गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू। द टॉपिक ऑफ दिस मॉर्निंग्स डिस्कशन विल बी ऑन साधना थ्रू वर्क। वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक। द टॉपिक फॉर दिस मॉर्निंग, ऑफ कोर्स फॉर दिस स्पिरिचुअल डिस्कोर्स फॉर दिस मॉर्निंग, दिस सेशन विल बी ऑन साधना थ्रू वर्क। सो दिस वर्क we do my mother said for the proper balance of the body some work is necessary. So we will quote this sadhana through work, the topic of the discussion of this morning, from the Sri Aurobindo's writings. As the master writes here, the ordinary life consists in work for the personal aim and the satisfaction of desire under some mental or moral control, touched sometimes by mental ideal. These are the things only for this selfishness work, only the mind touching and mental moral control, touched sometimes by mental ideal. All, everything is mental. To satisfy the mental, the ordinary life work is done. Gita, we know that karma yoga has got the more maximum priority in that Gita. We have seen that was Gita as explained by Sri Krishna to Arjuna on the very big battlefield. We have already seen, and the Gita's yoga consists of in offering one's work as a sacrifice to the divine. From Gita we have listened the thing, we have learned the thing, work as a sacrifice to the divine. The conquest of desire, egoless and desireless action, bhakti for the divine, and entering into the cosmic consciousness, a sense of unity with all creatures, oneness with the divine, these are the basic requirements we have already heard and we have gone through. These yogas, Sri Aurobindo quotes, so these are all ordinary lives, Sri Aurobindo quoted initially. Then Gita, of course, Sri Aurobindo, next in the middle, Sri Aurobindo has quoted. For this, now Sri Aurobindo quotes this integral yoga, the bringing down of the supramental light and force, its ultimate aim. The ultimate aim of this integral yoga is to bring down the supramental light force into this lower hemisphere. And descent of this supramental light and force, the transformation of the nature becomes possible. And next, Sri Aurobindo tries to differentiate between the ordinary work and the spiritual work. And previously the initial yogic concept and our integral yogic concept, men usually work and carry on the affairs from the ordinary motives of the vital being, needs, desire for wealth, for success, position or power of or fame, or the push to activity and the pleasure of manifesting their capacities. And they succeed or fail according to their capability. These are the selfish motives. They succeed or fail according to their capability, power of work, good or bad fortune, who is the result of their nature and the karma. As per their capacity, capability, efficiency, they have succeed or fail. The karma bad we have already heard. When one takes up the yoga and wishes to consecrate one's life to the divine, leave thy work's result to the supreme, all can be done in the God's transfiguring hour. Karmeno vadhukarastu ma phaleshu padachano. This the work you have to do, but the result, leave thy work's result to the omnipotence, all things will change in the God's transfiguring hour. It will be done and he will do it. Those ordinary motives of the vital being is no longer their full and free play. They have to be replaced by the another, because these all are selfish motives, ordinary work. They have to be replaced by another, a mainly psychic and spiritual motive. This is the condition. This is ordinary motive, ordinary efficiency. It must be transformed. It must be changed by the psychic and spiritual motive. That motive, psychic and spiritual, will enable the sadhak to work with their with the same force as before, no longer for himself but for the divine. This work done in contact is meditation. Work done in true attitude, that is meditation, that already we have known. So this psychic and spiritual, when it comes and replaces your own capability, own work, your own method, then naturally this will be changed. There will be a change of consciousness and everything will be given in the, done for the divine, and the purposes will change here. Then we'll go for this another couple of things. Any work can be done in the field for the practice of the spirit of the Gita. Any work can be done as a field for the practice of the spirit of the Gita. It can be done. It is possible. Then here in the course again, you use your force for the work, and it is supported you as long as you are prepared to stick to the work. What is the first importance? This is somebody has done. So Sri Aurobindo course then concludes to this question. Sri Aurobindo's advice is there. The most importance is not the religious or non-religious character of the work done. It is work. Nothing depends upon this religious or non-religious work. But the inner attitude in which done, already we have quoted, this is the inner attitude, true attitude, not the external attitude, artificial or superficial attitude. That is the inner attitude. What is the motive behind the work? If the attitude is vital and non-psychic, if the attitude is vital and non-psychic, then one throws oneself out in the work and loses the inner contact. There is no inner contact. It is only surface. It is only vital. So the next one is the psychic. During the course, if it is psychic, the inner contact remains. The force is felt, supporting or doing the work and the sadhana progress. So these are the distinction, there is the separation about the inner vital work and the psychic work. Next phase, Sri Aurobindo very interestingly quotes, there are those who have done the lawyer's work, the work of the lawyer advocate, with the mother's force working in them and grown by it in inward consciousness. On the other hand, religious work can be merely external, vital in the nature and influence. It is actually separation. There is a distinction. Lawyer's work, there is mother's conference, inward consciousness is there. But for this religious work, we are working with the vital in nature and influence. So there is a, even if it is, it seems to be greater, but thing is that it is only influenced by the vital. Next, we'll go very interesting definitions as quoted by Sri Aurobindo. One can both aspire and attend to the work and do many other things at the same times when the consciousness is developed by the yoga. Many things at a time it can be done. When actually the consciousness is developed by the yoga. So this consciousness, this higher consciousness have to be developed. The next one, Sri Aurobindo quotes very interestingly. If one feels a consciousness not limited by work, the word has been started from the if, not limited by the work, a consciousness behind supporting that is that which works, then it is work easier. If that consciousness is behind your devotion, your work, then the things get easier. That usually comes either by the wideness and the silence fixing and the extending itself, or by the consciousness of a force, not oneself working through the through the worker. So nothing, it is not the it is something higher, not narrower. So it works, that higher consciousness is there. Then very interestingly, Sri Aurobindo quotes here, the absorption in work is not undesirable to get absorbed in the work. Absorption in work is not undesirable, but the difficulty in turning into inward can only be temporary. If it is there, it is temporary. A certain plasticity in the physical consciousness, which is sure to come, makes it easy to turn from one concentration to another. So certain capacity in the physical consciousness, which is sure to come, that is to come, and this absorption is possible. Then there is no necessity of losing consciousness when you meditate. Very interesting thing. There is no necessity of losing consciousness when you meditate. It is the widening and change of the consciousness that is essential. Widening and a change of consciousness, that is essential. If you mean going inside, you can do it without losing the consciousness. There is no harm, of course, in raising the aspiration from below to meet the power from above. There is no harm. It can be done. It is possible. All that you have to be cheerful about, not to raise up the difficulty from below before the descending power are ready to remove it. So that readiness must be there. The resistance you speak of and the insufficient receptivity and the inability to continue in communion while doing work must be all due to some part of the physical consciousness that is not open to light. You have asked this inner physical that is not open to the light, for that the resistance is coming. Probably something in the vital physical and the material subconscious which stands in the way of physical mind being, physical mind being in its mass free and responsive. That for that is actually this response is, this is coming. It is a certain inertia in the physical consciousness here in the course. Inertia, certain inertia in physical consciousness which sorts it up in the groups of that doing so, and it is fixed that and it is not free to remember. So this inertia must go if that consciousness changes. Again, here in the course, it is not at first easy to remember the presence in work. To remember the presence and the work in the initial time, it may not be easy. But if one receives the sense of presence immediately after the work is over, it is all right. In time, the sense of the presence will become automatic even at work. In the latter period of time, initially it may not come. The unhappiness is not necessary or inevitable in the sadhana. The unhappiness is not necessary or inevitable in the sadhana, but it comes because your inner nature feels the touch of divine presence indispensable to it and uneasy when it does not feel it. That is the, for that actually the unhappiness is coming. Then if you feel it, what will happen? To feel it always a certain constant detachment within, allowing you to remain within and do everything from within necessary. This can more easily be done in a quiet occupation. Quiet occupations and the quiet contact, this is the basic requirement with this unhappiness will go. For this quietness and inwardness that enable one to feel the presence. To feel the presence, the most requirement is the quietness and inwardness. Again, here in the course, all should be done quietly from within. This is the basic reason we must remember. All should be done quietly from within. Working, speaking, reading, writing in the parts of the real consciousness, not with the dispersed and unquiet movement of the ordinary consciousness. From the ordinary consciousness, we have to move, we have to spin upwards, we have to spill upwards. Then everything should be done quietly from within, working, speaking, reading, writing, everything. One can work and remain quiet within. Work and remain quiet within. Quietude does not mean having an empty mind or doing no action at all. It does not mean. For the action to be psychic, the psychic must be in the front. This is the basic requirement. The observing Purusha can separate himself but can't change the Prakruti. It is there. So, psychic must be in the front. If you want consciousness for the true actions too very much and aspire for it, it may come in one of the several ways. Three ways Sri Aurobindo has quoted. You may get the habit or faculty of watching your movements in such a way that you see impulses of action to coming and you can see to its nature, number one. Number two, here in the course, a consciousness may come which feels uneasy, whatever and wherever wrong thought or impulse to action or feeling is there. Second condition. Number three, something within you may warn and stop you when you are going to do the wrong action. These are the indications it will be there and you will feel it. Then it is time almost, it is actually knocking at the door. Yes, with the right consciousness always there, there would be no fatigue if the consciousness is the right consciousness. When doing this work, you have to you had the force in you and the right consciousness filling the vital and the physical. Afterward, with the relaxation of ordinary physical consciousness came up and brought back to the ordinary reaction, fatigue took place and this is the real situation.